So we use for it a decomposition of SL2R into three one-dimensional subgroup, continuous subgroup A and K. A acts as scaling, N acts as horizontal shift, and action of K depends on the type of hypercomplex number we are using. It's circle, elliptic for complex numbers, parabolic for dual numbers, and hyperbolic for double numbers. We find a possibility to get a uniform treatment of it by using some conic section in higher dimensions. This is kind of interesting feature which really just indicate what we need to move in this direction, that particular unification will not be used later. We will do something better instead. And one of the important properties which we established, and we will make much use of it today, is that family of cycles and cycle are unify corresponding conic section is the elliptic, parabolic, or hyperbolic with straight lines as a degenerate type of conics, and points, isolated points, will be also included in these families. So it's called cycles. And that families of cycles are invariant under Möbius transformation. So what we will learn today is that it's better to consider the family of cycles as invariant objects rather than points themselves on the plane. And we link our construction with isotropy subgroup of imaginary units, corresponding imaginary units under respective Möbius transformation. Predictably, they are connected with these three types of one parameter subgroup K, A, and N, which we meet already on many occasions. And we conclude the previous lecture by making Möbius transformation a bijection. So an obstacle to make bijections is that we have a division by hypercomplex number, and division is not possible if a hypercomplex number is zero or zero divisor. And for complex number where we have only zero, no zero divisors, so this is indicated on the graph on the right column, just 0.00 is exceptional one. So we need to add one ideal element at infinity, also shown in red, and the correspondence between points of the plane and extended plane with this new ideal element at infinity is given by the Riemann sphere. For the dual numbers, divisors of zero make a vertical axis, so all elements of the form lambda epsilon, where epsilon is that dual hypercomplex units, square it to zero, they are all divisors of zero, of course, and division by them is not possible in within our algebra, so we need to extend algebra by some ideal elements, and they are again form the straight line, so we need just matching number of ideal points to divisors of zeros, and corresponding compactification is done by the cylinder. Finally, for double numbers, divisors of zero make the light cone, so that is lambda plus lambda j or lambda minus lambda j. So a pair of such straight lines need again to be put in one-to-one correspondence with new ideal elements added to our algebra. And we find what the corresponding object will be hyperboloid. One sheet hyperboloid with corresponding stereographic projection. So just to mention what this extension by ideal elements, it does not
produce a new algebra, not all operations are permitted in the new set, extended set, but it's not our purpose to make all operation permitted. We only are looking for possibility to perform arbitrary Möbius transformation, linear fractional transformation, and we want this transformation to be a one-to-one map. So this is purpose is achieved by such additional elements. And what we will learn a bit later, that all that elements which we added together, added in each respective case, they form so-called zero radius cycle at infinity. Actually, zero and or zero divisors together, they form zero radius cycle centered at the origin of our algebra. And so making a division by such element, we need to add a corresponding zero radius cycle, which centered at infinity. So that was content of previous lectures. So let's move further. So as I already recalled, we have an invariant family under Möbius transformation, which are cycles. So cycles, conic sections, represented, of course, by a quadratic equation. So if we will just look in very elementary analytic geometry, we have the corresponding quadratic equation for such cycle. So again, we are always attempting to make a uniform presentation of all three cases. So here we put that parameter sigma or the square of iota, hyperbolic imaginary unit, in front of v squared. So for elliptic case, it will give minus one. So we have u squared plus v squared. And for dual numbers, it disappeared, v squared. And for double numbers, it will be u squared minus v squared. So standard elementary analytic geometry, classification of quadratic equations and locus of loci of points represented by such quadratic equation tell us what we have: circles for this equation in elliptic case, parabolas in parabolic case, dual numbers, and hyperbolas in double numbers in the hyperbolic case. So what will be very helpful in our construction or in our consideration, this is so-called Fillmore-Springer-Cnops construction. This is association of this second order equation with a respective two times two matrix, where coefficients, arbitrary coefficients, which we have here, K, L, N, and M, are arranged in this special form. So probably I have to write a separate additional small video explaining the origin of this construction, why it appears. For purposes of main lectures, it just will be explained later why it's helpful, because it's allow to linearize linear fractional transformation. So instead of linear fractional transformation, we will have just linear transformation by matrix conjugation. So that is main reason. And actually, that correspondence between quadratic equation and two times two matrices is rather natural and fundamental. For this reason, it appears on many occasions. So Fillmore and Springer published almost simultaneously their paper with Young-Cnops. And that was independent work. And even after their work, say, Alexander Kirillov in his book, Two Tales About Fractals, discover a similar representation for cycles independently. So people just discover and rediscover that correspondence on many occasions just because it's really something very natural. So I will try to discuss that in a separate video. complementary to our lectures. So let's again discuss what we have here, the projective type of coordinates. So cycle is parameterized, of course, by its four real numbers, K, L, N, and M. But with four real numbers, due to homogeneous nature of this equation, are defined just to a positive scalar. So if we multiply simultaneously all positive, all these coefficients by a positive scalar different from zero, we get an equivalent equation. So it will be the same collection of the points. So that is, again, as we already know, correspond to projective space. So we have a point, rather when considering point in four-dimensional Euclidean space, we will better speak about three-dimensional projective space. So cycle represented either by a point in three-dimensional projective space or such a matrix, two times two matrix, which is shown on this slide. And that matrix also is defined just up to a scalar factor. So if we multiply by non-zero factor with two times two matrix, it still represents the same cycle. Very interesting property, actually, is that we have here in the two times two matrix also a hypercomplex parameter, which I denote as brief iota. And interesting feature compatible with Möbius transformations, which appear from SL to R, what this hypercomplex unit here, brief iota, can be independent from the parameter iota used in the quadratic equation. That means what we may have the equation in the elliptic case. So we consider circles as cycles. We are working in usual Lobachevsky geometry on the upper half plane. But a certain geometry, inner geometry of cycles, will be defined by a parameter which not necessarily of elliptic nature. It can be elliptic, it can be parabolic, or it can be hyperbolic. So just because our group of transformation is given by SL to R matrices with the real coefficients, so which hypercomplex unit is used here is really our choice. So it's important, behavior of cycles will be different depending on that second hypercomplex parameter, and but we can choose it independently from main iota on the point space. For this reason, I will oftenly speak about two spaces. It will be point space, which is collection of these pairs UV, which has certain geometry defined by the parameter iota. And we will speak about cycle space, space of cycles, which is projective three-dimensional space. And geometry in this space of cycles is defined by this parameter brief iota, again, which may be different from the iota in the point space. And as an example, let us consider the concept of a center of a cycle. So here the center is defined in terms of its center is belong to the or defined through the geometry of cycles, not points. So if say we have elliptic case, when elliptic center is just usual center of the cycle. So it's defined through parameter of the cycle, and from this equation and simple analytical geometry, it's easy to derive what it's really the center, as we know, center of circles in usual geometry. But if that parameter sigma, brief sigma is different from elliptic case. It's parabolic. In this case, the center of parabolic center of a cycle became the projection of the elliptic center to the real line. And if center is taken hyperbolically, then this hyperbolic center is just a reflection of elliptic center in the real line. So this is a relation which always happens between free center of any cycle. And just again, as illustrated on this cycle on the right, hyperbolic center correspond to the center of the cycle drawn as a hyperbola. So actually, we may start from the point space and then consider the family point space with respective geometry, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic, and then consider corresponding family, invariant family of cycle. Or we may think about space of cycles to be an independent or original setup, and then each cycle can be drawn in any of three possible ways, either as elliptic or parabolic or hyperbolic cycle. So here is just an illustration. As you can see, if for the same value of parameters K, L, and M, we draw our cycle as a circle or parabola or hyperbola, they are not completely independent. There are certain relations between them. In particular, if we have roots, if our cycle intersects the real axis, then all three cycles are passing through these points. So roots are shared by any realization of our cycle. So this is that lower left collection of elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic cycle. So they are sharing the same parameters K, L, and M, and just appear slightly different with some common points and some common features. And if it does not have roots, there is still a relation, say, between elliptic and hyperbolic realization of the same cycle, because, for example, center, elliptic center of the cycle will correspond to the will be reflection of hyperbolic center of the cycle. So this is how our cycles can be represented in three different ways for the same value of parameters K, L, N, and M. So, and that make our geometry really very rich. We may consider all possible 9 combination of 3 types for imaginary unit iota and 3 type of imaginary unit hypercomplex unit brief iota. So we may just have this 9 possible combination, 9 possible geometries which appears in this way. So just to summarize this picture, we simultaneously or just in turn may think about the cycles as being elements is a three-dimensional projective space. So that is given just a vector of coefficients K, L, and M up to homogeneity condition. Or we may think about corresponding 2×2 matrix, again up to homogeneity from Fillmore-Springer-Cnops construction. Or we may think about them as certain collection of points in particular realization. So a particular realization on the plane, which depend from the parameter sigma, which again can be taken arbitrary from the set of free. But projectivity somehow an excessive degree of freedom, which we often try to reduce, and that can be done at least locally by certain suitable normalization. So what we can do, if our parameter k, say, is different from zero, we can simply divide all coefficients in the quadratic equation by this corresponding value of k. So that is what we oftenly do in analytic geometry. So instead of considering that very general equation, which we have here, we may just divide throughout by k and say on the plane, in the elliptic case, we will have the equation of the form like that. Thank you. And then actually a brief reminder from the analytic geometry tell us what that can be reduced to the standard form of the equation of a circle with the center at points L divided by K and divided by K with a radius R squared, and that radius R squared really, as it's easy to verify, would be equal to the determinant of corresponding Fillmore-Springer-Cnops matrix. So that is one first nice connection of these two times two matrices, which we have for the cycle and the corresponding analytic geometry on the plane. So that is what we can, the normalization which can be done. But that is, of course, normalization is possible only in the case where k is equal, is different from zero. But if k is equal to zero, in this case, quadratic term disappears. We have a linear equation that exactly corresponds to the straight lines. And in this case, that normalization failed. And we may try some other useful normalization. One of them is normalization of this two times two matrix, which was used by Kirillov, proposed by Kirillov. This is normalization determined by the condition what determinant of corresponding Fillmore-Springer-Cnops matrix is equal to one. So that normalization is a bit more technically complicated than normalization with parameter k, but such a normalization has a very nice geometric consequences. In particular, we will learn about simplification, which is obtained for touching circles or touching cycles of any type, which appeared from that normalization. So, but again, this normalization, second Kirillov normalization, again, not always possible because there are cases where determinant of a given Fillmore-Springer-Cnops matrix is equal to zero. Again, from previous equation, when determinant of Fillmore-Springer-Cnops matrix is equal to zero, in elliptic case that correspond to the circle of zero radius. And if it's circle of the zero radius, that is represent just a point with this, which is center of this circle. So this type of cycles, which represented by zero radius circle, cannot be normalized in Kirillov way. So there is no universal normalization which help in all cases. So we may use just one or another depending of our circumstances, so about depending from our target. Next property which I want to discuss, that space of cycle is a vector space. Is a projective vector space. So it's projective vector space, three-dimensional one. And being a vector space means what linear combination shall have a certain good geometrical meaning. So if I consider two cycles, say with coefficients k, l, n, m, and k prime, l prime, n prime, m prime as vectors in the cycle space, and I try to make a linear combination with some coefficients, just because our space is projective is defined up to the homogeneity condition, we do not need to consider arbitrary linear combination. We may again normalize our linear combination. We may say, so let it will be cycle C, and let it will be cycle C prime. When we may normalize our linear combination by the condition what the sum of coefficient is equal to 1. So we consider this type of linear combination with arbitrary parameter C, T to be in the real line. So what will be the cycle, the new cycle with such a coefficients? So as for vectors, it's rather clear what does it mean. So, well, I make a drawing on the plane, of course, but it shall be represented in four-dimensional space, three-dimensional projective space. So we have C prime. So that linear combination R represent with linear combination with parameter T represents the straight line passing through the endpoints of these vectors. So this is a geometrical set of such linear combination. So as known from the basic analytic geometry. But what happens if I will draw a corresponding such C tilde on the plane? And here you may see illustration what's happened. So C here is given by the bold green cycle. C dash is given by the bold blue cycle. And from the very beginning, there are two possibilities, where is the intersecting or where disjoint. And then, well, here it may be a case where one cycle is inside of another cycle, but this is not a different case from what is drawn here, because from the point of view of fractional linear transformation, there is no such notion as being inside or outside. By inversion, which we will meet soon, we can put one cycle into another. So that is two general possibilities, and all that cycles C tilde, which are given as linear combination, are drawn here as well. As you can see, they are form what is known in geometry as pencil of cycles. So this is a pencil of cycles. For case where our two cycles are intersecting, then all cycles which are all linear combination of these two cycles, again passing two points of intersection. Ah, okay, so it can be the third possibility, when our cycles neither intersecting in two points, nor are disjoint, but rather are touching in one point, but it's almost the limiting case of the second situation where we have disjoint cycles, so, or it's boundary situation between these two pictures, really. So as you can see, in a sense, these cycles from the pencil are indeed make a linear span, and that points which correspond to t to be between 0 and 1, so it's point between end points, so t here belong 0, 1. This is drawn on our picture as that intermediate colors from green to blue gradually changing, so it's indeed like joining these two end points, and points which are outside are given in that reddish type color. So points which are outside of this interval given in the red type color. And that behavior we consider it in details on two circles, but if we will consider two parabolas or two hyperbolas in a similar way, we will have a corresponding pencil of parabolas and corresponding pencils of the hyperbolas. And it's worth to mention what notion of a pencil of circles, say, appeared in geometry in very early, so it may be several hundred years, much more before Fillmore-Springer-Cnops construction or consideration of a cycles as elements in the fractional linear transformation, but pencils of cycles which are naturally interpreted in terms of linear combination of vectors, geometrically proven for a long time to be very helpful. In particular, the straight line belonging to such a pencil has very distinguished properties, important properties in geometry. For example, the length of a tangent line to the any cycle in this pencil will be the tangent segment from the vertical axis will be the same. So if I will draw a tangent line from a point on this straight line to the green cycle or to the blue cycle, the length of this tangent will be the same. So that is one of the interesting property of these pencils. And if you will look into standard Euclidean geometry textbook, which is nowadays somehow shaded out of secondary school, and they are not considered in the high school either. So somehow that is the lost beautiful theory, which is not very familiar to modern generations. You will see what this pencil of cycles has very interesting geometry, many interesting properties, which in particular can be proven using that linear algebra which we have, that linear relation between corresponding points in the projective space. All right, so it was just an attempt to convince you that the linear structure in the projective space of cycle is geometrically meaningful. So this sixth picture tried to make illustration what where is the connection between these two presentation. Now we move to the next property. It's turned out what we may obtain not only the centers of a cycle, we also may consider foci of a cycle. Again, coming back to the Fillmore-Springer-Cnops construction, to the that fundamental 2 times 2 matrix which represent a cycle. As I already told, if we will do a bit of analytic geometry, we will discover what the determinant of this matrix, which represents Fillmore-Springer-Cnops construction, is related to the square of the radius of corresponding circles. But there are even more relation with determinant. We may consider a point with the following coordinates. Again, determinant is a quadratic in term of coefficients of a cycle, second order. So in K normalization, we need to divide it by K square to make it independent from the homogeneity parameter, to make it independent from scaling, so of coefficients. So we consider a point with such coordinates on the plane, and it turned out that for parabola, which represent the cycle drawn on the dual numbers, that point correspond to the foci of this parabola if we use the hyperbolic parameter brief iota here. It correspond to the vertex of the parabola if we use parabolic value of this parameter, and it correspond to the point on the directories. So I will briefly recall the standard definition of the parabola, which known from the analytic geometry. So the standard definition will be as follows. So if we have a straight line, which is called directrice, and if we have a point, which is called focus, then a parabola will be the collection of points which is equidistant from a straight line and the point. So we have here collection of equidistant point. That means for any point on the parabola P, the distance to the foci is the same as the distance as to directrice. So these two distances shall be equal for the parabola. This is the definition. So in this definition, obviously, these distances are equal. So these distances are equal as a consequence. So we have this focus, which is hyperbolic focus of the corresponding cycle, with vertex of the parabola here, which is parabolic focus of the parabola, and that is point on the directrice will be the elliptic focus of the parabola. So which is what is drawn on this graph. And here it's interesting to compare what we have before for parabola as centers, elliptic centers, say parabolic centers, and with three types of foci. So it turns out if we have the parabola, when position, when center and foci belong to the same vertical line, of course, because first coefficient L divided by K is the same as for centers. So it's the same as for centers and foci. So this is L divided by K. But the second parameter in the center is independent from value of M, and M tell us how much parabola is shifted vertically. So when you make a shift, vertical shift of a parabola, center of the parabola stay in place. Elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic is the same. So here we have two parabolas. Center of parabolas is really only depend from the focal length. So actually, the center, elliptic center is on the focal length of parabola. So this is the distance between hyperbolic and elliptic foci of the parabola. So here second coordinates is just equal to this distance between these two points. So if we do vertical shifts of parabola, centers are fixed of these parabolas, but foci are traveling together with parabola. So foci are glued to the parabola and center somehow are sticky. They stay on the same position of the plane. And again, that foci which we have here, they have natural geometrical interpretation or classical geometrical interpretation in term of parabolas. But if we will come back to the hyperbolas and circles, then these foci which we have here break through from the classical definition. So I would recall the classical definition for the classical definition for ellipses and corresponding hyperbolas. So for ellipses, the definition, a classical one, will be what we have: two points, two foci, F1 and F2. And property of the ellipse is that the sum of these two distances is constant for all points. So if we add together the distance of a point on an ellipse to the one foci and another, it will be a constant. And that in particular give us a circles if F1 is equal to F2, then we have simply the constant distance between F1e, which is of course a circle. So here, as we see in the usual analytical or classical geometry, foci of a circle coincide with its center. But again, as we have some differences in our projective geometry, so our case will be in our case that foci, which we consider it here, have parabolic origin and do not coincide with foci in the elliptic sense. Similarly, for hyperbolas, again, I recall the classical definition. We still have two foci, F1 and F2, and the property for the hyperbola is that the difference of these two distances is constant. So F1 minus 2h minus F2 2h. Thank you. Is constant. So we have two branches and we have asymptotes. For these hyperbolas in classical geometry, for our case, in our geometry, which we have hyperbolas, all hyperbolas are rectangular. So only rectangular hyperbolas appears. That means we have the right angle between asymptotes. So right angle between asymptotes and vertical and horizontal axes, symmetries of this hyperbolas, which appear in our case. Similarly, all parabolas which we have in our consideration has only vertical axis. So that is a restriction of geometry which appears from fractional linear transformation in our case. So as we can see, that geometry which we are starting to investigate, it has certain clear connection with classical geometry, but it has some important significant differences which actually would be rather difficult to guess if you stay in the classical approach, synthetic approach to geometry, but it appears naturally if we are considering linear fractional transformation and if we consider naturally invariance of such transformation in accordance with the Erlangen program. Probably a final bit which we consider today will be the zero radius cycles. As I already mentioned, in very elementary approach, so if we make the standard form for the quadratic equation defining a circle and we evaluate what will be the corresponding radius, it's connected to the determinant of the Fillmore-Springer-Cnops matrix, with matrix. But a determinant of this matrix is has a parameter. It depends from the corresponding brief iota, and it has different values for different brief iotas. So here we put the example of this nine type of geometry, as we said, when we use three different types of point space, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic geometry. This is for parameter iota. And when we put three independently, we choose three different values for brief iota. So here on the right column, used the elliptic geometry in point space, so iota is elliptic, but brief iota taking different value. If it's elliptic as well, then as discussed before, condition what determinant is equal to zero give zero radius cycle, which is just one point. But if in this Fillmore-Springer-Cnops construction we will use parabolic iota, brief iota for evaluation, when the zero radius condition, zero determinant, will define a circle which is tangent to the real axis. So that can parabolic condition give that tangency condition. And finally, if I will use hyperbolic brief iota here to, for evaluation, when the circle which I will obtain in this case will have 45 degree intersection with the real axis. So here it is 0 degree, here 45 degree intersection with the real axis. Interestingly, if for my drawing of a cycle I will use not elliptic but parabolic and hyperbolic geometries, then I will simply get very related picture. So parabolic determinant, parabolic value brief iota, each time produce a cycle which is tangent to the real axis, so that middle position real axis. The hyperbolic zero value give us the cycle which intersect real axis with 45 degrees. So in all three cases, so we have that thing. What happens if we do the similar calculation here for the analytic geometry, which is for analytic geometry with hyperbolic case? If here I will have U squared minus LK squared minus V minus NK square root equal to zero. So that correspond hyperbolic case where I use both hyperbolic geometry to draw my cycles and hyperbolic geometry to calculate the radius. Then I will get hyperbolic zero radius cycle, which again the light cone in corresponding center. So this is the light cone, two crossed lines which make 90 degree, so asymptotes of any other hyperbola with center. So that somehow nicely corresponds, so that it will be on many occasions seen as right zero radius circle representing the zero radius circle in the Euclidean geometry, which is just a point. So that two crossed lines passing certain points is that zero distance, hyperbolic distance from this point. But in parabolic case, none of such type of degeneracy occur, and that will require some additional discussion of parabolic case. So that right time to stop our lectures. Are there any questions? Thank you. Don't forget to mark your attendance, please.